I may have screwed up some technical difficulties here. Okay, now, do people hear us?
I hear us through the speakers.
Okay, there we go. Let's start all over again. All right. My bad.
All right. Welcome to whatever we're calling the Tuesday show today. We don't have a title. We just thought about it at the last second, and it was way too late by then. So yes, we're just going with whatever.
And I want to welcome back Mr. Gerald Abraham, L.A. Akira. Thanks again for spending 4 hours with us yesterday on Virtua Fighter 5 stuff.
Yeah. So. Yeah, that was awesome, man. Thanks for having me. I'm not going to recycle really the jokes from a few minutes ago.
No, that's fine. That's fine, yeah. They'll just have to read our lips and figure out what those jokes were. Yeah.
They were some good ones. There was you guys missed out.
It was something about being hot and sweaty, being near us and stuff like that. But, you know, one of the things that I mentioned early on is that, you know, I've known Gerald for a very long time.
Hey, turn down the volume on your computer or something, because I can hear it somewhere.
Yes, okay. But, you know, I've known Gerald forever, and he's actually one of the original old-school players of Street Fighter 2.
Original old-school.
Yeah.
You just wanted like to make absolutely title. Sure
yeah,
that you
exactly.
knew what we were talking about right
so
there.
So there's nothing beyond that. Right?
I think that's what he's saying. I'm not sure. Just to make sure, you mean he picked it up when it started.
There are people that are original, and then just original, you know. Then they're just old school.
Those people suck.
This is
categorizing.
Hey, you know what?
Level 1 originals are weak. Come on.
It doesn't even matter. Whatever I say, I'm part of that too, right?
Yeah, sure,
so I'm over there too. Except, you know, back, you know, during Street Fighter 2, original World Warrior, you know, you were one of the top players for that game. You played in all the Pico tournaments with Tomo, and you played in all the Pico Rivera World's Finest Comics tournaments and such. I mean, World's Finest Comics was the first, like, major tournament.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely,
like,
that was basically the proving ground. You know,
When did tournaments start for Street Fighter 2? Like, how long did it take for people to be like, oh, we should play this competitively in tournaments?
Well, generally, like, you know, even before we get to that, I'll just give you, like, guys, like, a little history of, like, you know, my experience with the game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? So, actually, even Street Fighter 1, I was playing that in junior high school because, you know, like, from, like, Karate Champ up until, you know, like, when we saw that game, we're like, wow, this is really cool. And then we figured out how to do fireballs and, like, dragon punches, so... You know, once we did that, there was basically all the Street Fighter 2 matches were, you know, Ken and Ryu doing, like, you know, dragon punch, dragon punch, dragon punch. But, you know, we still had a fun time, you know, playing that in, like, junior high. And then, generally, I mean, I just love Capcom stuff, you know, Strider, Ghouls and Ghosts, you know, they had the best titles back then. You know, it was just, like, all the, even Area 88 or, you know, UN Squadron, what you even call it over here. They had just awesome stuff, you know.
Right.
And, you know, we went to, we'd go to this one arcade down in Westminster, Beach Warner Arcade.
Oh,
I don't know if you've ever, but that place was actually a location test site for a Capcom.
Mm-hmm.
So they would get the, I think it actually is for C.A. Robinson's possibly, you know, which was like a distributor for arcade games back then. We would just go down there maybe like once a month or so and just see what like new games, you know, new games are there.
So cool.
Awesome.
Right. And during this time we loved Street Fighter, you know, like, I bought Fighting Street for like PC Engine and whatnot. And we played the heck out of that. And, you know, it was just, we just loved the game. And then one day we went down there to Beach and Warner Arcade and we saw Street Fighter 2. And we're like, oh my god! Yeah, we just thought it was cool because we were just like, you know, just Street Fighter 1 fans,
right?
You know?
Uh-huh.
And it was myself, a friend, two junior high school friends, Jeremy Corby and Andrew Cockburn. Andrew Cockburn worked at Game Fan Magazine.
Oh yeah, okay.
So he has his, you know, some people know who he is, and he was in the scene as well, you know, the Street Fighter 2 scene.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, we were all friends at that point. We went down there and. We were just like blown away, you know. We were just like really, really blown away, and it's like, you know, there weren't like two characters anymore.
Right, right.
It was eight characters.
And
know?
When
like,
one of them
oh,
won,
at...
you didn't have to let him lose to the computer to play again. Right?
We were just like so blown away because, like, I mean, the graphics at the time were just so amazing, you know.
Right.
You know?
So you didn't know that the game was coming out in advance.
No.
You just like showed up and like
There were magazines, but like, I mean, they're just like, you know, related to like console gaming. But I mean, generally there wasn't really like any type of warning. You know, it's like we didn't get, obviously there was barely any like internet. I mean, I think there were like BBSs back then.
Right.
So yeah, that's the extent of it. And you know, maybe like Morse code or whatnot. But
send the pigeons.
Send the ravens. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, that's basically all we had. We'd go down there sometimes, it'd be like a surprise, you know. It's right. Like, and then we're just totally blown away. The first character, you know, I looked at the roster, you know, I saw the eight characters on the bottom, and the first character I picked, you know, was Guile, you know, right off the bat.
I just thought
he looked cool, man. That was it.
He did.
So you know, we played, and you know, we just could not believe it. You know, we just like, this is so cool, this is so amazing. And like, there's already like a crowd, you know, and this is like maybe about like seven or eight people just like looking at the game and just, you know, like playing head to head and stuff like that.
Awesome.
And then you know, like I think no arcade had this at this point, you know, it was still like on test, right?
Oh, sick.
So it was just imagine, you know, life without Street Fighter, life before Street Fighter 2, right? And at this point, I actually found another location test site, which was in the valley, which was Plush Q, like this billiard place.
I've never heard of that.
And so I realized maybe that was like 2 days after we went down to Beach and Warner. And it's like, wow, you know, this place is like maybe about 15 minutes drive from my house. And then I'm just going to, like, I literally ditched school for a week to play this game. You know,
awesome.
Like, and I just thought, as this is before, like, any tournament, anything we knew about, whatever. And Family Fun Arcade, you know, didn't have a single machine. I actually, but that was an arcade we'd frequent sometimes.
Right.
So Family Fun was already a big deal back then?
Well, no. I mean, it was just an arcade.
Just one of the arcades.
Yeah, it was just another arcade.
Okay.
And, you know, it wasn't really, like, a big deal at all. Because, I mean, you'd have, like, the standard customers for, like, you know, like, Strider or whatever. Like, back then, there was no fighting game genre.
Right.
No versus game. Versus games. I talked about this in another interview one time, but it was just, like, I feel like Street Fighter actually brought games back to being competitive.
Yeah,
because
it was
all one player for the longest time.
No, that's not true. Basically, I mean, there were one player games, but what they started doing to make more money was competitive game, like co-op.
Right.
So like, you know, you Double Dragon, Bad Dudes, you know, that sort of
stuff. So it's like, instead
of making, you know, one quarter time, we can make two quarters of time.
Right.
Make this game hard as heck, and then these guys, we got two guys. Yeah, exactly.
Your health just drains.
Right. So,
I mean, that's kind of interesting because I know when Street Fighter 2 first came out, so the first time I heard of it was from my brother, and it showed up at UCLA.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody played against each other when it first came out.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
oh, yeah.
Like, because we were so used to the one-player stuff. I mean, were you guys right from the get-go fighting each other?
Oh, yeah.
No, that's pretty cool.
Oh, that's cool.
We actually wanted to see, like, at one point, there was this bald-head kid there. I'm sorry if you're watching the show. I don't know your name. But, you know, you were there, trust me. And we were watching you beat the game. You know, at first it's like, you know, we saw like a boxer. And you're like, holy cow. It's like, because it's not a character on the roster.
Right.
And you're like, whoa, who's this guy? What does he do? And blah, 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 blah. And then, you know, then it was like Vega, right?
Right.
And then it's like Sagat. It's like, oh my God, Sagat from the first game. And that's so cool. And then, you know, then we saw Dictator, you know. So it was just like we watched him like finally beat the game. We got the little, you know, funny ending and whatnot. And, you know, then we went back to like, you know, beating each other up pretty bad.
Gotcha.
Yeah. And anyways, you know, Family Fun, that was like probably like more or less like the closest arcade to like, I wouldn't say the closest, but probably like one of the best ones that we'd like frequent.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I actually went there and I didn't know the owner at the time, Ralph. But I would see this guy working there, Tim. You know Tim, right?
Tim's still there.
I think Tim is he still
there?
Yes, he is still there.
Oh, geez, okay.
Tim,
okay.
And Ralph still owns it.
Yeah. So I went up to Tim, right? And I didn't know any of these guys at the point. I'm like, you got to get this game, man. Street Fighter 2, it's going to be huge. And I swear to God I said this, right?
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, we'll see how it does.
Awesome.
Oops.
I like it, yeah.
And I'm like, oh, don't worry, you know, it's going to do well, you know. And literally, it took maybe like less than a month, and they had 8 to 10 machines. They had 8 to 10 Street Fighter 2s, and, you know, you could not get in there. It was like that brought arcades from like a level of just having like a certain amount of like one person playing a game to like just crowds, like a mob or like a rave or something like that. And, you know, they'd keep the arcade late, you know, open late. And it was just literally like Street Fighter 2 It was like a urinal at a ball game. You know, I mean, you could. You know, there were like a line of like five people
right.
just waiting
per
to play.
Machine.
Per machine. Yeah.
Per machine.
It was amazing. Yeah.
I was always heard the story because I worked at the UCLA arcade right. for a while, and you know, one of the things you don't remember, you don't realize arcades have to do, they have to collect the quarters right out of the machines at
yeah.
some point in time. And the guy who ran the UCLA arcade used to tell me that it was only during Street Fighter II, the original Street Fighter II, that they had to do collections twice a week.
Yeah.
Because the machines would
the
just...
The buckets would get
wow,
hit.
They
uh-huh.
were just
yeah.
raking
yeah.
it in, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense.
It was ridiculous how,
yeah.
how much those games were played.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was pretty amazing. But, you know, back to... After that, right, I think it may be like... We were just, you know, like discovering the technology as
mm-hmm.
it went along. Like I was, you know, telling you, like... we didn't know. I mean, when the game first came out, we were just learning, like, on the fly. And,
yeah.
you know, we hadn't even seen combos yet, you know.
Right.
Like, one day, like, somebody came by, and this is actually before, like, the combo, before the combo was invented.
Uh-huh.
It was just short kick.
Uh-huh.
Somebody figured out, I think it was Andrew that actually figured out short kick.
Short,
yeah.
Awesome.
Go,
so good.
Dude, I mean, well, I mean, I'm sure
nah,
other people figured
news.
It out. What's that?
It must have been big news.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's just like all of a sudden we're having like an even match, right? And then now he starts doing this and it's like, wow, he's like winning most of the time. What the heck, you know?
Yeah.
For people who don't
yeah.
know,
yeah.
short, dizzy G.
Yeah.
That was a dizzy
yep.
combo.
Yep.
And then you would walk up and go short again.
Yep.
And you would have drained them about 80% of life
yep.
in the original Street Fighter 2.
Yeah.
So
that's
crazy. I mean, I'm not saying he's the inventor of this, obviously.
Right,
but
right.
for
yeah.
our group, you know, for like the family fun
yeah.
group, he's the guy that, you know, figured that out,
mm-hmm.
right? So he would just go short throw or short throw. And then it's like, man, this is unbeatable. You
wow.
know?
He actually
yeah.
was using the throws
yeah.
back
yeah,
then
yeah,
already,
yeah.
huh? Oh, wow.
And it's just like, man, screw this. And he just started laughing. And I was like,
oh, I got you.
But
wow.
did you guys not have the like cultural taboo of throws?
Well, back then it didn't exist because there are no boundaries of to what the rules were. Those come later, you know what I mean?
Okay.
Yeah.
So like back then it was just like, you know, whatever you needed to do to win, you know. So I would just like, you know, basically all like, I mean, for myself, just you know, quickly figured out that holding down back for Guile was the way to play him, you know, because you got your Sonic Boom, you got your knife kick.
Well, how did you figure out which like how you do a Sonic Boom, how you do a Flash Kick? That kind
we
of stuff.
Within like probably like a week or two, we figured out that like, there
Dang.
Were like special moves.
Rad.
You
Dang,
know?
That's crazy because I know like so my brother would report to me their findings at Street Fighter
right.
oh, cool.
at the UCLA all the time, and literally the only time players, including Doug, actually
right.
could throw a Sonic Boom was at the beginning of the round because they would just be holding
they
back.
Right.
Doing
that was
so
it.
Round one fight, they'd throw a Sonic Boom and they'd never be able to throw it again because
yeah.
they just didn't know you had to charge it.
Right.
And Doug was the first person, he might have just learned it from playing with you guys or something, but he was the first guy to
awesome.
Learn how to charge it, and then all of a sudden he started spamming it at the
yeah.
arcade, and everyone
so
was
good.
Like, whoa, what is this?
See,
you know?
Here's the logic behind it, right? We played Street Fighter 1, so we knew Kenryu had a Hurricane
oh.
Kick, we knew they had a Dragon Punch, we knew
right,
they had a Fireball.
Right.
You know, so it's like, all right, these other characters, they have to have something. And they have to have something. So we started just doing anything. You know? We started doing fireballs with Guile.
Right.
We started doing spin kicks
course,
with Guile.
Yeah.
You know, and then all of a sudden, I think it was like the beginning of the round. And it's just like, you know, holding back.
Uh-huh.
And then maybe just trying to press forward and press punch. And you see him go like that. We're
yeah.
like, whoa, what was that?
Right.
You know what I mean? So that's how that, you know, for our group, you know,
huh.
like sort of came about.
I still even remember the story. Like, sometimes you would see the computer do spinning pile driver
yeah.
with Zangief.
Yeah.
And no one could figure out how to do it. And I was just like, no, it's impossible. It would be too good if people could do it. It's just a computer only move. And we would literally sit there and mash controllers. And then
Try
one day
out.
We would
yeah.
just mash it and it came out. And we were like, oh my god, you can do it!
Yeah. We actually figured out, like, the idea of the special moves, like, pretty quick, because,
mm-hmm.
like, again, like I said, I mean, we knew that Ken and Ryu had, like, special moves, so
right.
they're not
oh,
going
right.
to make a game that had, you
well,
know, Ken
true.
And Ryu with, like, these special moves, and everybody else is just screwed, so.
Right.
That's true.
Well, some people still got screwed in Street Fighter 2.
Yeah.
But.
For sure. In fact, Ken and Ryu kind of
got
screwed,
yeah,
because
yeah.
they were
pretty
bad
much.
In that
yeah.
game.
Yeah.
yeah. They were
yeah.
really bad.
We'll get to that later,
yeah,
I guess.
Yeah.
You know,
but let's go to a commercial
sure.
break, actually, and I kind of want to talk about like when you met Tomo
okay.
and all that
yeah.
stuff like that.
Sure.
Okay.
Cool.
So we'll be right back. Yep. So stick around for some more history of.
You have another one? Is that all
yeah,
right?
It's all you.
Thank you very much.
Hey, welcome back to Tuesday, I don't know.
whatever day.
Yeah, whatever. So we're talking about Street Fighter history, more or less.
And we're waxing nostalgic about version one of Street Fighter 2.
Yeah, I gotta be honest, I did not realize that there were multiple versions of Street Fighter 2 World Warrior.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, I was just telling David during the break, and I think I told you this a long time ago, but the original version of Street Fighter 2 is the only version of Street Fighter that's ever had a true 10-0 matchup.
Yeah.
Because literally, Zangief could SPD Honda at the beginning of the round. It was just round one fight, SPD. You didn't bounce away. You fell right next to him, and you jump and crossed him up, made him lose his charge, and then there was nothing you could do.
Right.
You, three SPDs, and he was dead.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah.
That was it.
So
it was a really fun game.
I know. But yeah, then there were multiple versions. Like, I think even in the first version, like, every character standing roundhouse, like Ryu and Chun-Li and everyone, would beat, like, everything. And I think they toned those down by the time they got to version 3.
Right.
So jump attacks were more powerful.
I honestly had no idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're actually, there are, like, denominations of, I think there are two versions of version 1, and then there are, like, like four versions of version 2, what was considered version 2. So version 1, you know, specifically just, you know, has where you could Dalsum can actually 2-in-1 slide into like a fireball, and it would glitch out the game because the next hit would stutter.
I haven't seen that one. No, I didn't see that one.
That was only he could do that in version 1, so he could do like a 2-in-1 from like a low forward into like a low forward into flame or low forward into fire, and then if the next button you press, it'll stop and then go, you know. So it was
weird,
a bug. Yeah.
Weird.
So it wasn't fully thought out, but that was deleted in version 2.
Yeah.
You know, all the bugs in the game were still all the way up to, like, version 2, the end of version 2.
Right.
And then version 3 is when they had completely no bugs. Right. Everything was taken out.
Yeah, because the early bugs were all mostly caused by Kara canceling throws into special moves.
Yeah.
That's how you got Guile's magic throw. Right. That's how you got Dalsum disappearing and stuff like that. And they just didn't know that that would happen. And I think that's what, you know, they fixed that eventually.
Yeah.
So.
Right.
Yeah, and then also there is a special version, and we'll talk about this later, how I met one of you know, my good friends in Japan was through you know, these Street Fighter versions. And there's one version of Street Fighter 2, it's version 2, where it had a certain date. When you turned on the machine, you know it was because it was a certain date. Let's say Capcom, and then blah, blah, blah. When you saw that date, that was the version that did it. So what you could do is, I know you've seen this, where like Guile could strong throw, and then he could hold a razor kick, right? He could charge a razor kick.
And then
the second roundhouse, the second kick you press after that, second time you press kick, will always be a razor kick.
Right, I remember that. Huh. Like, you throw it the strong button, instantly charge a flash kick, and you can charge it in time so that you do the flash kick before he recovered, and it stored it.
Yeah.
And the next kick you hit would make you flash kick.
But you had to do, you actually had to do the razor kick with forward. If he did it on the roundhouse, it turned off the game.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
That's awesome.
And you know what? Awesome. I told him this earlier before we started.
Yeah.
I love the fact that he's calling it razor kick. Because you've heard me call it razor kick
all
the time.
No,
right?
I know. Yeah, I know.
It's the old school term.
Yeah, I know it is.
We have so many old school terms. You know, for like Zangief jumping fierce, we used to call that the beer mug, you know.
I can totally see that.
Yeah.
That.
Yeah.
That's so awesome.
I think George came up with that.
Oh, okay, yeah. I can see that. Yeah. I can totally see that.
Yeah, there's a lot of good stuff.
We were gonna start talking about Tomo and all those guys.
Like, so when did Tomo?
Introduce him first. So I'm sure people don't know who we're talking about.
Right,
so.
Tomo Ohira is probably, you know, for the United States, obviously we didn't play around the country and stuff like that, but I think it's pretty undisputed that he was the first great player of Street Fighter II, undisputed champion of the country, you know, and maybe even the world at the time, you know. He was so much better, and I mean, my favorite story that I always told is they traveled around to all the arcades, and I ran into him and Tony Tsui, right? They came to our arcade. That's how we found out about World's Finest. The first tournament I ever went to, Tomo was just like in the middle of the tournament. He's like, you know what? I'm just going to beat this guy with only the short button using Guile. I'm just going to flash kick and just run around and short him all day. And he just destroyed this guy. And it was just the saddest thing. I mean, he did it in tournament.
Sick.
So he was just like humiliating this guy. And it was, yeah. And then I remember he used Ryu and he would uppercut Chun-Li's low forward kick. And if she didn't kick, like, he wouldn't uppercut. Like,
He reacted? Oh, because it was much slower, I guess.
Yeah, it was much slower, but he must have been doing, like, high-level tactics, like uppercut, oh, there's Lord and hit lunch. Right, none of us did any of that stuff back then. So, but it was crazy. He was so ahead of the game.
Yeah.
And he was one of the best players. And he's basically the first champion of Street Fighter. So
basically how I met him is, and found out about Pico Rivera was, I think it was maybe like 2 or 3 months, might have been a little longer, into like Street Fighter 2.
Mm-hmm.
We're, you could imagine, we're playing this every day, you know, we're all ditching school, and, you know, it was, our lesson was taught in the arcade, you know, so,
yeah.
That's what I mean. You went to UCLA, so I mean, you kind of couldn't, you know, you had to go there to play it anyways, but...
Yeah. Honestly, the very first day Champion Edition came out, I was sick from home. I was sick from school. I was at home because I was sick, and I crawled out of bed, and we went.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah,
oh,
wow. 100%. Brad. So, I mean, I know, trust me.
But, yeah, I mean, we were, myself, and there were probably about, like, 3 other guys. We were, like, the best guys at Family Fun. You know, it was, like, undisputed. I mean, I'm not really, like, talking smack or anything like that. But that's just how it was. And, you know, the people back there, they know, you know. They knew.
Uh-huh.
And then one day, you know, I came in, and my friend Jason is like, oh, man, there's this guy. He's just, like, killing all of us, you know. So we can't do anything. You got to get in there and beat him down, right?
Uh-huh.
So, like, I mean, I played him, and this is Roger Chung, right?
Okay, he was the...
So Roger just absolutely destroyed me. I could not do anything.
But which characters were you using?
It was just Garland Dawson. We already knew at that point that was, like, the strongest.
Oh,
you know?
For real?
Yeah, okay. I mean... but it was just, I mean, the technology, the stuff he was doing is like, you know, once he gets you down with like Dalsim, he'd just do the spear throw and the mummy throw.
Right, right.
And then Guile loses his charge. Sometimes you try to knife kick and you still get hit by the sit and hit in the head.
Right.
Or like, you know, just cause like Dalsim's throwing range, it was bigger than Guile's.
Yeah.
It was bigger than Guile's. So, you know, as soon as you made him lose his charge, he couldn't do anything. He'd just, like, get, you know, like, outranged.
Because throws were instant. They were one frame back then, so.
Yeah. So, I mean, it was just like, man, he would just get me, or he got me in the corner, and then, you know, just fireball trap, and it's like, I couldn't get out. I tried to jump up and jump back, and then just, like, guess the one time that he's going to throw it, and he would just, like, push himself back into safe distance and start it over. And, like, you know, it was almost like, at that point, when I got beat that bad, you know, I just, like, I mean, it didn't piss me off. I actually got really happy, you know?
Yeah, I know
got
exactly
really, really happy.
I know exactly what you
but,
mean.
But, I mean, it sounds like, you know, the classic martial arts movie, you know, the cocky American guy just gets, like, schooled by the master. I mean, that's pretty much what it felt like because,
awesome.
You know, he turned me, like, he really got me interested in the game.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like now I wanted to learn what he knew, you know?
Right.
So he told me about, like, oh, yeah, you know, I go to UCLA, I know, play with those guys, and there are actually these tournaments out in, like, Pico Rivera. Right, and you know, there were like a lot of good players there, you know. So,
how far into the game was this in terms of?
I think
time?
It was maybe about 4 or 5 months, you know, something around there, you know.
Yeah.
And you know, we went down there, and then we would do the same thing. We would go down to like you know, every arcade we could find and see who's, you know, who can beat us, and like literally from like, you know, the San Fernando Valley. And, you know, some of San Gabriel and even, like, Santa Monica and stuff like that. I mean, we just couldn't, you know, we were, like, maybe some people would win some matches, but we were getting the better of them, you know, until we met Roger, you know, and then Roger just destroyed us, you know.
Yeah.
And, but, yeah, he told us about this, he told us about Pico, and then we started going down there, right? And we just, I mean, there are some really strong guys, you know.
Yeah.
There are some really, really strong guys, and it's just, like, all of a sudden, you know, it's like...
The world opened up, you know.
It's just like, you know, like a tiny fish in the ocean. You know, it just finally found its way to the ocean. It's like, oh my God, look at all these huge sharks here.
Yeah.
And, you know, honestly, like for the first couple of weeks, I was so intimidated by some of these guys, I didn't even play, you know.
Yeah.
I didn't even play, yeah.
Dang.
Yeah.
I mean, I told a story in that Red Raptor documentary at that one point where, you know, where Tomo and Tony came by and they showed... And we went there to the Pico tournament. It was the third ever World's Finest tournament that they ran. And seriously, you know those movies where someone will walk into like some new training and there's all these people who are really expert in the background and you're like, and the main characters walk around going, whoa.
Yeah.
You know, that's exactly what it was when
it was
we walked
scary,
in there.
It was
yeah,
really
it was
awesome.
It was scary, but like you said, at the same time, it was just like, I didn't know that this game could be played this way.
Right, exactly.
You know, the first time I saw Chun-Li run up at the start of the round, and it was like, round one fight. She walks up, stand fierce, and punches Guile before the Sonic Boom came out. I was like, wow, you can beat that? And then I would try it. It would never work. You know, it was just like the concepts didn't make sense back then, but it's just, you saw people do stuff. It was so cool.
And then I remember, you know, like those four guys, there were like, there were the three gatekeepers, and then there was Tomo at the top. You know, Tomo was like the, you know, the like the final boss.
Yep.
You know, like, you know, he had like the, I wouldn't want to say, I don't want to say like level one boss, because, you know, Tony and Willie and Roger, they're obviously a lot better than like a level one boss, but.
Willie, Sana, Roger Chung, Tony Tsui.
Willie Lee, actually.
Oh, Willie Lee, that's what it is, yeah. And then
Willie was second, I think, most of the time. Oh, I think I think Roger and Tony were fighting for third and fourth most of the time.
Okay.
But Roger, I mean, he would always, like, you know, talk about himself. He's like, man, I suck, you know? He was just like, I can't beat Tomo, you know?
So he's the first Edma.
You know how it is, yeah.
He's the first Edma. Okay,
super good, but you lose to one dude, so you suck.
Roger was so awesome, man. He was so strong, man. Yeah. He was really, really so strong. And this is Street Fighter 2. It was before, like, you know, like, obviously, like, a lot. But, I mean, all the technology, I mean, you know, almost like when we found out about these guys, we found out about, like, just Pico and stuff, it was like a treasure trove, you know?
Yeah.
And, like, every strong technique, I mean, these guys had already figured it out. You know, like, for example, you know, just like standard flow charts back in the day, how Chun-Li beats Guile. It's all off the low forward. Low forward and then back dash, low roundhouse in case he sticks out the low roundhouse. You know what I mean?
Right.
Or a low forward.
Right.
So, or then if he, like, you know, if you bait him and then he's scared to stick out the low forward, he goes low forward, or low forward throw. You know what I mean?
Right,
or low
forward
standing fierce to beat the Sonic Boom.
Right, right.
So, I mean, they had, like, you know, or they would just, like, you know, jump up and down in his face and then tries to razor kick, run up and throw.
Yeah,
so
it was like, wasn't, like, Chun-Li Dalsam, like, almost, like, super hard because you could just strong him in the corner?
Yeah, exactly. Just, I mean, you could almost sometimes, like, let go of the button and Dalsam is still stuck blocking.
Yeah.
And you just go strong.
And
strong,
you could
strong,
only
yeah.
drill. Once you reach the height of your
jump, it was
not a direction, right?
Right.
Yeah.
So all of his moves were too slow that once you started strong him in the corner, you could just react to any time he jumped and air throw him back
right.
down.
That like makes sense.
If he was just dead, it was game
that
over
makes sense.
At that point.
So were all the characters being used?
Yeah, there were actually experts. There was, I think, Sunny Fong, I think it was. Or there was one guy who was, like, he was the expert, the best Ken and Ryu player at that point. And then George, I think, George Nago, he was ranked fifth or sixth. At that point, he only used Honda, right? Yeah,
oh,
Honda.
Really?
Actually, he used Honda and Dalsam, but Honda was his main
Street
Fighter 2.
Okay,
and that's when I met him. And he's the one that just showed me how Honda just totally kills Ken and Ryu. You know, he walks them into the
so
corner,
funny.
Yeah.
And it's just like, you know, like low jab, you know? And
yeah,
that's all you have to
uh-huh.
do. They can't spin kick over it.
They couldn't
as soon as they
like
try to jump, stand, you know, like
yeah,
fierce.
Uh-huh. And the fireball, yeah. We just go Hadouk and get stuffed by jab.
Exactly.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. You couldn't do anything. You just, once you got walked in the corner, you're pretty much done. So that obviously, you know, we know why George was ranked over Sonny, you know?
Yeah. Well,
and that was, I think Sonny was like around 7, I think. George is consistently around like 6. You know, he had, like, the top 10.
Right,
I mean, you know, we got in there somewhere, but, I mean, we were back in that game in Street Fighter 2, in the beginning of Street Fighter 2, it was, like, in the 20s and stuff like that.
Yeah,
it was just 1
yeah.
through 20.
Right.
So we were, like, you know, like, just scraping the 19s and 18s. And like, yeah, got in there.
I'm on the board.
Yeah.
So how many people were playing at these?
Oh, man, they're, like, 40, 50 people.
Sick.
You know? And then every week you'd get some new guy that, you know, just thought he was hot shit.
Yeah.
And then he's gonna come in here and beat Tomo and... Tomo just, you know, he would beat him so bad the guy would never even show up again.
Ooh, man.
It was bad. It was really, really
matches,
bad.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And at this point, Jeff wasn't around.
Schaefer
wasn't around. As far as I know, he was actually, he's in the Marine, so I think he was in Desert Storm.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's
so
crazy.
He was, I'd never even seen him for like all of like Street Fighter 2.
Right, right.
You know, so I only met him in like Champion. But yeah, I mean, it's back then it was those three guys. And then it was Tomo at the top all the time. And, you know, you could not get
right,
in there.
Right,
nobody
right.
ever even got close to, like, you know, getting top four.
Yep.
So, and then top five or six was reserved by
cool.
George. And then Sonny. So it's like, you know, at that point, you know, it's like, all right, these are the guys I can't beat. Now, who can I beat? You know what
yeah.
I mean?
It's just kind of funny because, like, I mean, you know, going back to Virtua Fighter a little bit, that's kind of what it's like right now, right? There's like five gods of Virtua Fighter that nobody can beat.
There
right?
are, I think, about like 5 to 10 guys that are pretty much like in the, on like a level of their own. You know,
right,
I mean,
right.
it's pretty amazing. Like, I mean, they have a special gift for it.
Right.
And I think that honestly, there are probably about like 100 super strong players in wow. Japan, uh-huh. but they're mostly in Tokyo, and they'll beat the rest of the country.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, anyway, yeah.
Back to Street Fighter. Well, Street Fighter for tonight.
Let's take a break and then talk about.
Okay.
I guess we were about to talk about Championship and Shaper.
Yeah, a little bit more. A little bit more Tomo stuff.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah.
Awesome.
All right. So we'll be right back. All right, welcome back, everybody, to the Tuesday History Hour.
There you go.
Or hours, or however long it may be, so.
Yeah.
But we were talking, we've gotten to the point about, where you started going to Pico and
right.
playing against Tomo and all those guys. Mm-hmm. And then, here's a question. Was Mike Watson around during
no.
the Classic time? No, he came in around Hyper Fighting.
No, Champion Edition. Champion Edition,
yeah. Okay. Him and Jeff Schaefer then
yeah.
came around
yeah.
Champion
okay.
Edition. Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
So, we didn't really know Tomo. Like, we started, the more we played, he started being cool to us. We started talking.
Right,
we realized, all right, this guy's a really, really nice guy. The thing is, though, what people have to understand is Tomo was, about 14 years old at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
And he's beating people that are in college, at UCLA, that are, 18 to 22. And, when you're a kid.
I didn't know he was that young.
Yeah, when you're a kid, your mind is not, the strategy, your strategic aspect of your mind isn't developed as much as, an adult is.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the baffling thing, for, somebody like Roger, who, is a very, very smart guy. He's very technical,
right.
very smart,
uh-huh.
but he could not beat Tomo,
Right.
And he just didn't know why,
And the worst thing about it is, Tomo, we were talking about this a little bit, that Tomo, it was all instinct, because
yeah.
nobody, there was no technology back then. There was no such thing as concepts. You just
yeah.
played and won. So there was no, whiff punishing, baiting. It was just natural to him that everything that he did.
Yeah.
And so... It had to have been super frustrating for someone like Roger
yeah.
to lose to this,
Yeah, because Roger is very, very, technically oriented
yeah.
and just, statistics. He's a statistics player.
Right.
So, he was very good at what he did, but at the same time, he's got this one, this riddle that he couldn't solve, and it was just, I'm sure it was pretty irritating for him, but not just for him, for, a lot of people. So, generally, we started to go, to UCLA Game Room, a little bit more, and then just
right.
Hanging out with Roger and George
and
whatnot, and
yeah.
Doug, and we started getting better and getting all that stuff down, and started getting higher on the boards and whatnot, and
mm-hmm.
Becoming friends with Tomo a little bit more.
Right.
But yeah, then after that, Champion Edition was announced. This was '92,
mm-hmm.
and then a bunch of us drove down to San Diego, Yellow Brick Road, where they had a location
right,
test for that.
That's right.
Ooh, nice.
So yeah,
is that when you guys met Romedy, Kumi,
yeah.
Painter,
exactly.
all those guys.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Exactly.
Right.
That's where we met all those guys,
Yeah.
And then,
did they ever come up to World's Finest?
Yeah, they did.
Oh, they did.
Yeah,
oh, okay.
They totally did.
Okay, so
huh.
you knew them a little bit before.
Yeah,
then.
Yeah.
Okay,
we pretty much met them there, and it's just it's sort of the respected, gunslinger sort of thing,
Mm-hmm.
It's these guys obviously could play, and it's all right, these guys know what they're doing. So they're good players, and, they definitely know, and they understand the game, and, so we kind of, hit it off really well. Especially
right.
George and James because they're both Dawson players.
James
so.
Romedy.
Yeah,
right,
James
right.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So we're. I mean, could any of them beat Tomo?
No, not even close. No. Back then, I don't think Kuni showed up until Champion Edition, if
okay.
I recall.
Oh,
you
yeah.
know, actually, well, yeah, we did. It was Champion Edition
okay.
when we met him. So, duh.
Now, was there any SoCal NorCal competition back in Classic Street Fighter 2 days?
Not so much. Not so
okay.
much that I know of. Because what was the main thing that was all what really determined it was there was a national tournament for Street Fighter 2.
That was with the pinball machine, right?
No, that was...
Oh,
okay. There was one for just regular Street
oh,
Fighter 2.
Oh, okay.
And I didn't actually play in that, but, it was really set up. The brackets were set up where you had to, you had to, pick, the character that was given to you in, a drawing. So, Roger and Tony and Tomo and Willie, they played all eight characters really, really well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, I'm not sure if they knew about how the setup was going to be, but they played every character really well. And I think, Tony actually won that tournament. Tony,
mm-hmm.
If I remember correctly, it was Tony that won. Because I think Tomo got maybe Zangief versus Guile in Street Fighter 2.
Right,
so, there you go.
Right.
Yeah, there's not much of a chance.
Oh, okay. This is something that I've always wondered. When did 2 out of 3 double elimination start?
I'm not sure. I mean, honestly, I mean, we had loser's brackets back then, you know.
Yeah,
even in,
it was always like that?
In
Pico, it was loser's bracket.
Yeah, it was always loser's bracket.
And it was 2 out of 3 in the...
Yeah, I think so.
Just started out like that, huh?
Uh-huh. Yeah. I mean, that was just, you know, that's just like how we're told the tournament is. Like, all right, you know, all right, cool, yeah. And then we also had back then, which is really cool, you could, like, challenge people for their rankings. You know? I don't know if you remember that.
Because World Finals had that board that was 20. Right?
Getting on there was really prestigious. Mm-hmm. You know, so we'd like pick on whoever, like, you know, number 19 or number 18. And how it's set up is like you had to pay for their games. You know, you had to basically, you know, like if you're challenging, you know, for their spot, you have to pay for their games.
That's so cool.
Yeah, and even if you lost, you still have to pay for the games. But you know, that's pretty much how, like, how the setup worked.
Dude, that's so cool.
Yeah, it was really fun.
Yeah, I mean, it's really cool because, I mean, there was that one GamePro guy that came out with that interview with Tomo, and you can see the board of 1 to 20 behind him. And a lot of those names, dude, they were all the same people who were there all the time. I mean, I think I know 18 out of 20 of those people that were on that list.
That board, I mean, like, it fluctuated depending on, and, you know, like, you know, I just want to get this clear. I mean, other than, like, the people that were, like, you know, ranked, like, 1 through 4, you know, for, like, the different versions of the game, there are, like, you know, there's the constant, you know, the group, you know, whoever the group was, everybody in that group was very strong, you know.
Right.
So I'm talking about, like, you know, Eric Tetley and Roger Sahavo and, you know, all those guys, Martin Vega, all those guys, they were very, very strong players. And basically, who was higher in, you know, in ranking really depended on either the matchup or how much they were playing, or, you know, if they were into something else at the time, or even if they just didn't show up at tournaments. Because if you didn't show up, like, you know, weekly, you'd lose your spot, and you just, like, get kicked off the board.
Yep.
You know?
It's pretty remarkable to me, like, how dense of a time period this was taking place in. Like,
oh, yeah.
It's not like now where, I don't know, I guess, I think of these things that you're talking about, like, they should have occurred over, like, a couple year time span. But, like,
this is, like, 6 months.
It was, like, 6 or 7 months. It might have been, like, you know, like, I mean, like, it was so long ago. Literally, it was, like, over 20 years ago, you know. It was 91. It's scary to think about.
Yeah.
Sorry, guys. We're all really old here.
All right.
Sorry, man. I didn't mean to do that.
No, it's okay. It's okay. It's all
the first time I played Street Fighter 2 was on the Super Nintendo, so.
Yeah. Dude, I remember when it came out on the Super Nintendo, I was so happy.
Yeah.
I was so happy.
Even though it was, like, so ghetto, but, I mean, it was awesome, you know?
Yeah,
it was just
great to have it.
Oh, we got Street Fighter
2
at home!
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I played in the arcades occasionally, but I didn't have any way to get there for the most part, so.
Yeah, so, I mean, at that point, like I said, we went down to, you know, the Champion Edition when that came out, and when, we went to the location test, and when the game finally came out, it was freaking huge, you know.
Because
this is supposed to be the successor to Street Fighter,
right?
And now you could play, like, the bosses, and you could also play character versus character,
right?
You know,
it was
the first time Street Fighter 2. If somebody got Guile, you could not pick Guile.
Yeah, because before it almost was like a race. Yeah. You had to race, or in tournaments they would flip a coin to see who picked first.
Exactly.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I
so
was
whoever got
that.
The whoever got one got to pick the character, and the other person got to pick the side.
Yep.
But If you got the wrong draw in the first game, if it was 2 out of 3, in the next game, could you pick your character? Could you switch, or
no?
The
guy
got
to keep the character. Yeah.
Yeah.
They
couldn't exactly.
Get...
Yeah, you'd have to, like, honestly, like, you'd have to, let's say, I mean, I think I can't remember what the rule was for that. I mean, there was some sort of, like, I remember Tomo maybe lost on purpose, you know, one game so he could switch characters or something like that. Yeah, because I think he was, like, in one tournament he was stuck with, like, Dalsmi wanted to use Guile or something like
that.
And not, like, I mean, it was any like, you know, any problem. I mean, Tomo's Dalsim in Street Fighter 2 was one of the nastiest Dalsims I've ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
He just basically gets you, trap you in the corner and get that range, and then just, you know, chip away with, like, you know, fire. You know, just fierce fireball.
Throw you, or
you
whatever.
You wouldn't even bother. You just, like, you get that distance, and you just couldn't get out. You were stuck.
Wow.
You know? And any time you guessed, he just knew. He just knew.
Right.
So, but Champion Edition came out, and then, you know, the game was getting even more hype, and, you know, people that, like, kind of sort of, like, maybe, like, played Street Fighter 2, and then maybe started falling off. As soon as Champion Edition came up, it just blew up again. You know.
Yeah.
And then Family Fun had, like, you know, probably, like, 12 machines. We're having tournaments, like, every week. And they were driving down to, like, Pico, like, all the time. Because
I remember, like, that. I said I ditched. I was sick, and I ditched going and went there.
Yeah.
When I showed up there, everybody was there. So Roger Sahavo was
there.
Eric Tetley was there. everybody like showed up to that, and it was a school day, and everybody yeah. was there. That's and awesome. So it was just like,
It was really great, man. And at that point, when Champion Edition came out, the rankings sort of changed. I think Willie at that point, I didn't know Willie very well, but I heard he moved to San Diego. And so he wasn't really playing. He wasn't going. He obviously mm-hmm. couldn't make Pico. Roger and Tony showed up for tournaments probably like the first few months. But then we had, you know, we had some new kids on the block, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there was Jeff who showed up. I'll tell you about Jeff later. But it was basically what I remember at first. It was Tomo was number one, and then after that it was Mike Pozzo. And Mike Pozzo, I think, I don't know what happened to him. I think he might have got kicked out of the comic book store or something like that.
Right.
But
it happened frequently.
Yeah, it happened sometimes. And then Watson, you know, who was third. Then there are two guys from Simi Valley. There is, I think it was
Ventura
Alan
County.
Alan Fernandez and Ben Kutcher.
Oh, Ben Kutcher.
Ben was good.
Ben
was strong.
Yeah,
he was really, really strong. Mm-hmm. So he was just basically, I mean, he played Guile, but for the most part, he was like, you know, Dictator player. You know, he's, mm-hmm. he was very, very good.
Right.
And in that version, obviously, like, CE Dictator was just like the
right.
cheapest thing
but,
on Earth.
I mean, like,
you know?
Is it true, from my memory of Champion Edition, Bison was the best character in the game. The best person who could fight him was Guile,
yeah.
and Bison still won that match. Right?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is... Guile, once he gets Bison full screen, it's hard for Bison to get in.
Right.
You know, because he just keeps throwing the fierce sonic
mm-hmm,
booms.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't even bother with the slow ones.
Mm-hmm.
He just keeps throwing, like,
right.
the fierce ones and either block or, I mean, if you try to jump in, he does roundhouse. If you try to, like, do, like, a head stompy air throws, you know what
right,
I mean?
Right.
And then just pushes you, like, full screen.
Right.
So, I mean, even if you play, like, Mike Watson at that match,
mm-hmm.
you will guaranteed lose. You know,
right,
he's, like,
right.
really, really good at that. I'm sure there may be, like, a few people that would, like, you know, give him a challenge, but... It's just so hard, man. It's just so
and
hard.
I always said,
yeah.
like, the one thing that a lot of people didn't know about Bison back then is that he could scissor kick over Sonic Boom.
Yeah. It was random. That was
yeah,
that was a
yeah.
random factor in the
yeah,
game.
Yeah,
You start the round, I mean, you know, like, you had to sometimes start the round with the Sonic Boom because, like, if you didn't do it all the time, you'd be easier to read.
Right. right.
So, mm-hmm. you know, you did it sometimes, but there was, you know, just sometimes he just, like, double kick over it clean.
Right.
And then it's like, that's game, you know, because
right.
he does low strong,
right.
standing forward. And you're
dizzy.
Done.
You're done. Yeah.
You're done.
And he has a the world's
yeah.
well, actually not the world's first, but one of the most practical re-dizzy combos.
We had re-dizzies. I mean, Street Fighter 2 is
right,
all about
right.
re-dizzies.
Yeah,
almost
yeah,
every
yeah,
character
yeah.
had a re-dizzy.
That's
true.
Yeah. That's true.
But he was the only character in Champion Edition that had a re-dizzy because
right.
Guile's got nerfed.
Right.
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 right. So he didn't have re-dizzy anymore, and neither
right.
did anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
But he did, you know. So.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what was the character selection like back then? Was it pretty much Guile and Bison? Or?
Well, I mean, everybody at first. I mean, everybody tried to play everybody, you know.
Well, yeah.
But, you know, everybody, like, within the first, like, you know, month or so, realized how powerful, like, Dictator was, you know. And then it was just the tournaments just started turning into, like, you know, Guile versus Bison, you know. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
That's so fast.
That was the entire, yeah, it was a few months, you know.
Just a little bit of a tangent. I think is it Korea or Thailand or somewhere where they're playing Champion Edition
Korea.
Tournaments? It's Korea right now. They're playing Champion
they
Edition
play,
tournaments.
Wow.
And there's a lot of times you'll see, like, Sagats and stuff like that. I have you seen any of those matches, I wonder?
No, not recently.
Okay.
I mean, I think, like, at that point, it's been 20 years, guys, you know?
Yeah,
so,
yeah, yeah.
I mean, there are, like, obviously some new technology. If you play the game for 20 years...
yeah, exactly.
Everything is going to look very, very slow,
right,
you know?
Right.
And
right.
compared to the speed of games we have now...
Yeah.
You know, like, Street Fighter Champion Edition was very slow.
Right.
And then Street Fighter 2 is even slower.
Right.
You know, it's like, I could probably, in Street Fighter 2, I mean, I could, like, I've got a fairly decent percentage of, like tripping Guile's low forward in
yeah.
Champion Edition.
Uh-huh.
It was very easy to see. But
yes.
if I go back to Street Fighter 2, I think it's, like, 100%. I don't think I'll
yeah.
ever miss that,
yeah.
you know?
Uh-huh.
So, you know, from a certain distance, Guile just cannot use that move because he'll respect
mm-hmm.
you being
mm-hmm.
able to trip it.
Mm-hmm.
Hyper Fighting is harder, you know?
Yeah.
Hyper Fighting is
yeah.
a lot harder. But, you know, the speed of the games back then was a lot different. So, I mean, you know, when we were playing the game, you know, something as, like, something like a point-blank, like, double kick or, like, you know, the fire log or what they call the psycho crusher or whatnot. We called it double kick and fire log.
Right,
those are
right.
Fire log?
Fire
that's
log.
Awesome.
Yeah, yeah. Those are the nicknames.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
But, yeah, I mean, they were just, like, you know, if, you know, from this distance they did it, you couldn't react, you know. You
yeah.
couldn't react
yeah.
to Dragon Punch,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, and then we pretty much just, within a few months, we just, like, ironed out. It's like, okay, most of the tournaments, you know, it was either Guile or it was Bison. Every
right.
so often, you get, like, a Chun-Li or a Dalsim. Dalsim was pretty decent against, you know, Bison if he got him in the corner. just flamethrow. Because the flame would knock you down. You know what I mean? So, like, I mean, you wouldn't be able to do anything.
Right.
And
yeah,
basically,
no wake-ups, yeah.
Yeah, and then, again, even in this game, Champion Dalsim's throw range was, it was longer than Bison.
Yeah.
So Bison could sometimes, you know, after he'd block the flame, and then sometimes you get a double kick to beat the throw, but then the headbutt would sometimes beat the double kick, you know?
Oh, right.
Yeah, remember that?
Accidental option select. You just hit fierce.
That was probably one of the first option selects ever.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's take a break really quick again. I guess we're going to keep going because they said there's
no
cross counter.
Yeah.
And I actually want to get into one of the topics I really wanted to talk about, which is your trip to Japan.
Sure, yeah, absolutely.
About Champion Edition time. So.
Okay, we'll be back with that after this quick message from some sponsor.
All right, welcome back, everybody, to the Tuesday show. We have our guest, of course, Gerald here, talking about a lot of the history of Street Fighter. We're in the Champion Edition era at this point, and this was at a point where you started getting really good. You were one of the best players at this point, right?
Well, I mean, it was sort of like a turning point for me. I would say, like I said, I mean, there was like there was Tomo, and then there was Mike, and there was Mike Pozo. It was really, really awesome as well.
Right.
But we were in the top 10. You know, there were like a few of us that were in the top 10. And, you know, Roger sort of fell off, you know. And it's like, I mean, it was sort of like a thing for me where, like, you know, Roger was the first guy to, like, really beat me down. But, like, I mean, I got to a point where, like, I was actually beating him.
Right,
you know what
right.
I mean? And it's just like, it really, like, you know, it, like, hits you. Like, wow, man, I have really, you don't even notice it. But you're like, wow, I really made some progress,
right,
you know.
Right.
That's cool.
When did Frank Quang start getting in?
I think it was End of Champion and then Hyper Fighting.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, mainly Frank and I started hanging out in like Hyper Fighting.
Okay.
But how many days a week were you playing, and were other people
pretty
playing?
Much like every day?
Every
you know?
Day.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, at least like 5 days a week. I mean, it was like working out or something like that.
That's awesome.
I mean, back then, quarters were worth a lot more.
Yeah.
Too,
that's true. They were. No, they were. That's
25
true.
25 cents. I mean, you know,
it's true.
It goes a long way,
right.
Especially if you know how to play the game. It really goes a long way.
Yeah.
So.
That's true. I mean, me and Eric Tetley actually always joked, like, you know, sometimes going to the arcade on a Friday night was, if you were good, was like the cheapest Friday night.
Dude, I've thought about that too.
Possibly have. You
it
know,
was the same way for me.
Dude, if you were good, you would spend like $2 for the entire Friday night,
yeah.
Maybe another like $3 for whatever crappy pizza they
yeah, exactly,
sold there.
Yeah.
And $5, you just had the most fun. It was like the an incentive to be good to save money that way, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. There was this one time, it was some arcade in Marina Del Rey.
Uh-huh.
I went down there and I was like, on one quarter, I was there for like 2 hours.
Yeah.
And it was
oh,
just
okay,
like,
so what's the biggest win streak that you saw back in the day? Or did you guys remember that?
I don't remember. I mean, I personally, when I was in Japan, I got like at the Gamist shop.
Mm-hmm.
I had maybe, I think like 34 or 35 or something
nice,
like that.
Nice.
It might have been more. I don't want to, you know. I know it was at least that much,
right,
you know.
Right, right.
But again, it really depends on like the caliber of players you
right.
know you're playing.
Sure.
If you're playing against Tomo, you're not going to get a 30 anything win streak, you know.
Right,
you're gonna,
right.
He's going to get a 30 something
yeah,
win streak.
Exactly.
So
okay, so you just mentioned it
right
now and I hinted at this when I first announced we were going to do these shows.
Right.
I said trivia, you may be the first person, you know, L.A. Akira might be the first person to really ever go from US to play against a Japanese player and really find out how good we were compared to them.
Right, right.
Right? And so, during Champion Edition, you actually went to Japan.
I did,
right?
Yeah.
What was that trip for?
So, basically, at this point, my friend Andrew Cockburn was working at Game Fan Magazine.
Uh-huh.
Right? And another friend of mine, Kei Kuboki, was also, he was the international correspondent for the magazine.
Okay.
And I wasn't working there, but I was friends with him, so I just, like, you know, show up every so often. And, you know, I was good friends with Kei, and Kei knew that Andrew and I both played, like, Street Fighter, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, he was, like, and they were going to go to, like, Japan, you know, for, like, you know, buy stuff. For they also had a retail store which called Die Hard Gamers Club.
Okay.
Right.
Cool.
So they would go every so often to like, you know, get stock, like rare games.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they'd go to like, you know, Softmap and Akihabara and stuff and just, you know, buy the stuff and, you know, for like, you know, the collectors out here.
Because
there was no eBay, obviously. There's no internet.
Right.
So, you know, they would occasionally go back and then during one of the times they're going to go back, you know, Kei saw that there was a national Street Fighter tournament, you know. So a national Street Fighter tournament for like Japan, right? Uh-huh. For like Champion Edition. We're like, and I actually, you know, I wanted to go to Japan. I'd never been to Japan at this point. You know, I didn't speak any Japanese, or I was interested, and I've been interested in the culture since I was a kid. But I didn't speak anything, and I really wanted to go. And then, you know, it just turned out that, you know, I got my ticket, and I was able to go with, you know, Andrew and Kay. And Kay entered us both into, like, the national tournament, you know, the qualifiers. That's for awesome. The national tournament. Yes. The problem was, you know, there are limited spots per character, right? And how the national tournament was set up was, like, you had qualifiers for, like, each region, but it was also per character. So
right, so literally, if you wanted to play Guile in the tournament, you had to enter a Guile-only tournament.
Guile, yeah. It was really strange.
to basically represent that character.
Yeah, wow. Exactly, yeah.
Because it was the first time you could play same character.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
So that was the hustle for that.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, jeez.
So I basically got stuck. I mean, I knew maybe about, like,
quick question. Was this a Capcom tournament?
Yeah, it was.
Official Capcom tournament.
Oh, for real?
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, it wasn't just some, like, you know, it was a national tournament.
Wow.
Know?
Wow.
Okay. Yeah.
So how many people entered in the tournament?
Probably thousands. You know, it was probably, like, literally thousands of people, because, I mean, it was also really, really huge in Japan.
Right.
And, you know, I'll get to that stuff later, but there were a lot of people, and, like, what they'd have to do is, what they do for, like, you know, Virtua Fighter now, is, like, I'm sure they do it for the other games as well, but, like, you know, there are so many, they're like precincts, you know,
right?
And then, like, each precinct would have, like, a tournament, and the best player of that precinct gets entered into, like, you know, the final, like, 16 or the final 32 or whatnot. So that's how they chose. And anyways, Kay and Andrew and I, we went to Japan, and I knew maybe about, like, 2 weeks or 3 weeks before that, okay, well, you know, there's a spot for Ken. So I started learning Ken, playing Ken a lot. And, you know, I started getting pretty good. And, you know, we got to, I'd never been to Japan before, so I was just totally blown away and, like, how cool it was, right?
Right.
And it was just, even before, like, playing in that tournament, I was just blown away how many strong people there were, you know?
Right.
It was just amazing, you know? It was like, because we knew Tomo, you know, we knew, you know, Mike, and, you know, just like the top 10 and the top 20 players, and we knew they were, like, really strong. And then, you know, we would go, a friend of Kay's, who's obviously my friend now, this guy named Takahiro Yagi, he was actually, at that point, the best Tetris player in the world.
Sick.
Yeah,
that's so awesome.
He is amazing. Okay. And he actually introduced us and showed us around to, like, different arcades.
Nice.
We went to the Gamist shop one day. I don't know if you guys know Gamist magazine.
Yeah.
They had a shop in Kanda, which was a little bit, maybe about, like, 15 minutes walk from Akihabara. And you know, we went there, we met this guy, and, you know, he started showing us around, and, you know, he took us to, like, a couple arcades. He took us to this one you know, called Bicky's, which was on a basement. It was also in Kanda, as far as I remember. And again, I mean, the players are, like, really, really strong, you know? So it's like, all of a sudden, you know, like, I'm in this mix with, like, I mean, it feels like we're back home playing at Pico, you know? It's like, wow, these guys are really strong, but, like, you know, their styles are, like, a little bit different, you know? So, cool. I mean, it was weird, because, like, I could tell they're strong, but they played differently than we did.
Like, how different was it? I mean, was it kind of,
let's say, for one example, you know, they had really interesting strategy that I'd never seen versus, like, Dictator, like Chun-Li versus Dictator. You know, they'd just jump back and forward, you know, just, like, run up, jump back and forward. Or they just, like, yeah, it was just really strange stuff. Because it's like, and then you're like, well, I'll just Psycho Crusher. It's like, whoa, I just got hit. You know what
I
mean?
Right.
And at this point, we'd never seen that sort of play before. You know, we just thought Chun-Li just loses that match really badly.
Right.
But, you know, when it came to, like, the, you know, the Guile versus Dictator matchups, it was pretty much the same. And it's like, yeah, I mean, they knew what was strong. But, I mean, we had that stuff down to science, because that's all we did. We're just, like, friggin' robots with that stuff, you know? Sonic Boom, Sonic Boom, Sonic Boom. He jumps, you know, like, air throw.
Right,
know?
Right.
But, you know, then the anti, you know, strategies, you know, Dictator versus Guile. We had, you know, either, like, the try to jump on his head when he's not ready, you know, strategy. Or we had the one where you just, like, walk forward and block. Yeah. And then try to roundhouse him through the Sonic Boom.
Right, right.
Yeah, and then if you get two of those, he's dizzy, and then you win. You know?
Right.
So, I mean, you know, we, like, I played those guys, and, you know, these are just, like, you know, they're just so many strong people. It was just, like, I was, like, blown away. It's like, wow, they're good. But, I mean, there was nobody that I ever played there, I mean, at those arcades, which was, like, you know, getting a streak on me or something
right,
like
right.
that.
So, and you said you got a streak yourself there, right?
At the game of shop, I think I had like 34 or 35 or something. Which character? Like that. I was just playing Ditch Hitter, you know, at that point. And then, you know, obviously he was strong, but, you know, there were some good guiles and they knew how to play. But at the same time, it's like I wasn't really threatened. And, you know, I wasn't feeling like drowning like I'm playing like Tomo or Mike or something like that.
Okay.
But yeah, I mean, that's there's also another awesome arcade called Jack and Betty's. Who was
Jack and Betty's in Japan?
Exactly. Yeah. It's like, don't ask questions. Just be happy it's there.
Yeah.
So I mean, it was just, I mean, literally it felt like, I mean, I'm playing like, you know, there are like 20 Eric Tetleys or know 20 Roger Sahavos you know, they were you know, the same. It felt I was playing like the same guys, you know, skill wise, but there are just many more of them. You know what I mean?
Right.
Just, I would say, you know, the best way to sum it up is like, I don't think they are on a stronger level, but I think there are more people on a higher level.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, I mean, let's say if Pico Rivera had maybe like 50, like pretty strong players, they maybe had like, you know, 1,000, you know?
Right, right. But you don't feel like at any point in time any of those guys would have been able to like consistently beat Tomo. Tomo probably would have beat most of them. Right?
It's hard to say. I actually met Tachikawa, who is the former, you know, national champion for Street Fighter II.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I met him in 1994. You know, I met him later on, and I played him in Super Turbo.
Uh-huh.
And you know, he was really, really strong, but I was getting games off of him sometimes.
Okay.
So, and I was getting games off Tomo sometimes, but I wasn't getting games off Tomo when it mattered. You know? So, but I mean, I could feel it. You know, I could feel like, you know, when you play somebody that's stronger than you, it's almost like being in a vice. You know what I mean?
That's
the best way I could like describe it.
Yeah.
And if somebody can't do that to you, it's like, even if they're strong, it's like, okay, well, you never made me feel like I felt like when I was playing Tomo. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like if you lose to somebody, but you feel like you could have done something about it, or if you lose to somebody and you're like,
That's the vice
there.
Yep.
Yeah. That's the difference. That's a big difference.
It's but I mean, again, you know, back to like the, you know, the Champion Edition Gamist tournament. So we went back to the Gamist shop another day, and then we had our tournaments, and it was just basically like a Ken versus Ken bracket. And this is also the first time I played on a Japanese stick.
Oh, dang.
So I don't know if, like, you know, back then it was a really, really big difference. You know?
Square gate versus round gate is huge.
Not just that, but I mean, like, the Japanese sticks are really loose. And we had these, like, thick, like, bat controllers.
Yeah.
We had the bats, you know.
And the tighter they were, the
tighter.
Exactly. So, I mean, you've been playing on this for, like, about a year and a half or, like, 2 years or whatnot. And, you know, all of a sudden you've got this, like, loose, like, feels like it's almost broken kind of stick. Like, what the heck is this, you know? And I remember just, like, you know, even before the tournament, just going to, like, random arcades, I would pick Guile, right? And I try to throw a Sonic Boom, and he's like, you know, it does, like, the jumping fears. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
forward by accident.
It's like, man, these people must think I suck, you know?
That's awesome.
Oh, man.
So how did the tournament go?
It was good. I think I got either second or third, but only the winner goes on. That was only, like, I think maybe 32 people, and they're all Ken players. It might have been 16. But
still,
you know,
I mean, you got second or third on foreign sticks, you know, using a character that you weren't even... isn't even close to being your best.
I don't want to make excuses, but I mean, you know, that's just, you know, that was the situation. I was just like, you know, thankful to even play it.
Right.
You know?
But I mean, that's really impressive that you got that far. You actually look like you're super disappointed that you didn't win.
That's not a big deal. I mean, you know, I think I could have done better. You know, I definitely think I could have done better, but whatever, you know, I mean, and that was the main qualifier to get into, like, you know, the big cheese. And, you know, had I gotten into that, I would have had to book another flight to Japan,
because
that was, like, later.
Yeah,
it wasn't, like, the
yeah.
next day or anything like that.
So why did you choose Ken and not some other character?
I didn't have a choice. There was basically, there were slots, right? And by that point, you know, the precinct's already filled up for, like, all the other characters.
It.
All the guy was done, you know?
Yeah.
That was already first thing filled, obviously.
Makes
right.
sense.
The only thing that was, like, empty, I think there was maybe a Zangief and, like, a Ken.
Right.
So I'm like, all right, I guess I'm going to stick to, like, Ken.
Yeah,
so that's
sense.
That's who I picked.
Right, right.
And yeah, I mean, that's pretty much how it went. And during that time, like, my friend that I was telling you about, Yagi, we became friends, you know, just geeking out over, like, the different versions of Street Fighter 2.
Right.
And, you know, we were obviously playing Champion Edition at that point, but we were still interested in, like, all the bugs and, like, all the weird Easter eggs,
right?
And they'd known about, like, all the same bugs that we discovered over here, like the Guile handcuffs and stuff.
Yeah.
You know, they knew about that.
Magic throw.
But,
yeah.
You know, like, Guile would get stuck, like the handcuffs, right? We did not know. There's no person in America, I could guarantee you, that knew actually how to get out of it. You know, there's a technique for getting out of it.
The handcuffs, yeah. You mean?
Really?
Yeah. Well, the magic throw worked, right?
What do you mean, magic throw?
You know, the one where Guile just does a throw animation, and then the guy just falls, right? The one that Chan's brother found.
I'm talking about the one where they get stuck next to you, and they're stuck in a frozen state.
Yeah.
Right, and at that point, there was no way out of that. There was...
Oh, for the guy stuck, right?
Yeah, for the guy stuck.
I didn't know that there was a way out.
Yeah, so there was no... I mean, as far as, you know, the United States is concerned... there was no way to get out of that. You were just, if the time ran out, the game had to be reset.
Right.
So, how I made friends with Yagi was he actually showed me how to get out of that. He showed me the technique, and it took me about like 10 minutes to get, like, it was a really, really unique motion. You had to do like sort of like a weird sonic boom with, I think it was like strong and forward, right? And then he would like actually throw him out of it, and then you could start playing again.
So you're stuck in the handcuffs.
Yeah, you have the guy. You're Guile, right? I'm Guile, and I can move around, and I can do stuff, right?
Right.
But, like, you know, let's say Blanca, he's stuck in that, you know, like, hit animation.
Right.
And, you know, he can't do anything. Right. And then as soon as the time runs out, game over because he gets stuck. Right. But before the time runs out, with Guile, you could do this sonic boom with, I think it's strong and forward, right? And it wasn't a standard sonic boom, man. It was a really weird timing.
Right.
So you actually had to, I think, hit the buttons when you went, I think it went back, hold, charge back, and then forward back, and then he would actually strong throw you out of it, and
you could start playing again. The magic throw.
I brought that back from Japan because we did not know. Nobody, I guarantee you, there's not one single person that I've ever seen doing that over here.
You know, there's actually one person that I can actually say that I think was doing the magic throw, and he found it himself.
Really?
Actually, yeah. But did you know Chan? He used to go to Pico Rivera every once in a while. He was friends with Roger and Eric Tetley. Mm-hmm. His little brother just basically spent the entire time. And he, I remember one time he came up to us. He's like, I don't know what I did. Like, I threw a rock or I threw a comb. And, like, the guy fell over. And we're like, you're so full of crack.
Yeah.
So he might have found it at one point in time. But I don't know.
See, at that point, like, you know, every place that had Champion Edition didn't have to worry about it. But I can tell you there were, like, countless Street Fighter II machines where you just see, like, the character stuck and the time over, you know what I mean?
And Guile's just standing there.
Yeah.
Because he would do the wind pose, and then it just would never finish.
Yeah. So I brought that back, and Yagi, you know, he was nice enough to show me that.
Right.
It was a really, really difficult input. Right, you know, finding something like that is, you know, I couldn't have found it myself. I didn't find it. He showed me how to do it.
Right.
And generally, like, the trade-off was, like, I told him about this one version of Street Fighter 2. It's like, well, you could do, like, a razor kick. You know, you could guarantee do a razor kick without ducking.
Oh, the sword one, yeah.
And he's like, no, you can't do that. And I'm like, all right. And he actually had, he was at the gamer shop. He was working there. He had every version of Street Fighter 2. So I'm like, this is the version you need. Check out the one with this date, right? And so we, like, I think, like, fired up, like, three or four of them. We found that one. I'm like, all right, this is the one. I'm like, watch. And I showed him. He was just blown away.
That's awesome.
So we actually taught Trading Japan technology. Something back then. Yeah.
That's so cool.
Yeah, they did not know about that.
Right, that's awesome.
Yeah. Well, I mean, maybe like Capcom knew about that. They must have put that in there on purpose. But like the players didn't know about
that. Right.
And, you know, again, it was like a really unique version. You know?
Dude, that's crazy. Yeah. That's so crazy.
So, yeah, that's how I met Yagi. And he started introducing me like a lot of people. It was actually through him that I met Tachikawa and Itoyama, which were like considered some of the best Street Fighter 2 players in Japan.
Okay, that's cool. But I mean, one of the main things that, you know, I kind of wanted to get across to the people watching is just that, you know, the level of play, because there's always this mythical assumption that Japan has always been better than us and destroyed us and everything, and we've been trying to catch up since the beginning, and this just simply wasn't true. Like,
yeah, I mean, honestly, it's really like I felt like you know, like I said, I played Tachikawa in 94, and I felt the general, you know, skill level of like the players there, and there were probably like I think like a few guys which were like super duper strong. There were like maybe 5 or 6 guys in Japan which were, you know, I don't know. I mean, it's impossible to say if there would be Tomo or not, because at that point it's literally just like whose instincts are better, you know, in certain situations. So unless you actually saw like the matchup happen, you could speculate all you want, but there's no way to prove it, because, you know, it's like, you know, like Mayweather and Pacquiao, you know, you could talk all you could talk all you want.
Awesome.
Like, oh yeah, this guy's going to fight and this guy's going to win and blah, 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 because of this. But, you know, until you actually see the fight, there's no way to prove it.
Right. But the nice thing about it is it was actually that way. Like during the prime of when we didn't know how to play third strike.
Right.
You didn't need to see us play against each other to know that we were going to get destroyed. I mean, it was just that much obvious that they were better. And in this situation, you know, from just watching, it was definitely like an even level.
Right. I mean, there's only so much you could do with that game. You know? I mean, literally, the game was fairly slow. And there were like certain technologies that for like other characters that they showed me and that I saw on like videos. Let's say, for example... Dalsim had like some like weird juggles after like the Noogie. I don't know if you remember that stuff.
There was some weird. Was this in Champion Edition?
In Champion Edition. So let's say for example, Boxer, if you grab Dalsim with a headbutt, you could get like three hits. You know, while he's falling back in the air.
Some combo videos.
You know, or like Blanca when he bites, he could just like ball under you and then just jab electricity. You know.
Right.
That sort of stuff we didn't know about over here. We didn't know about it in the USA. And, you know, I brought some of that stuff back, and it actually really came in handy because, like, when I came back from Japan, you know, Champion Edition got to, like, a point where, you know, everybody knew that, like, Guile and Bison were the strongest, and the tournament sort of got boring, you know, because it was just, like, it was, like, almost like a game with, like, only two characters.
Right.
Wow.
So what they started doing, they started having no Bison, no Guile tournaments.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
So, it was just totally awesome back then, and I think it was literally, like, 2 weeks after I got back, or it might have been the same week I got back from Japan, you know, from that tournament, I went to, like, Pico, and they had a No Bison, No Guile tournament, and, you know, I entered it, and like I usually do, and that is when we met Jeff, you know, for the first time.
Jeff Schaefer.
I'd never seen this guy before. He's just talking a lot, you know. He's just really loud, you know. It's like, who is this guy, you know?
Right.
And, you know, we both entered the tournament. And the thing about Jeff is he knew how to play every character really, really well, you know. And I did too. I even if I wasn't the best with, like, every single character, I knew every character at least to, like, a playable point where, you know, like, all the matchups, you know.
Right.
It didn't matter. I mean, I just definitely knew, like, all the matchups.
That's cool.
Right.
But, we played in this tournament, and Tomo got knocked out early because he obviously, you know, he was still really good with the other characters, no doubt. But, I mean, if you get a bad matchup, you know, I mean, you're just kind of screwed. But he kind of got knocked out. I remember where he got knocked out. And then I played, Mike was there. Mike played Ken. I played Dalsim. I beat Mike. And then it was Jeff. It was basically me and Jeff in the finals, right? And Jeff had never seen me before. I'd never seen him before. And I'm just, like, listening to this guy, and he's like, I'm playing, I think I was playing Blanca at that point, and then Jeff was playing Dalsim, right?
Right.
So Jeff was, I just heard him, like, overheard him, like, talking to, like, some guy. He's like, no Blanca is going to beat my Dalsim, you know? And it's like, I was, like, thinking, it's like, I didn't know this guy, I mean, he's just, like, already, like, talking all this smack, and
that's
like,
awesome,
what is this, you know? It's like, man, I didn't do anything to him.
Right.
I didn't do anything to you, you know? But
so you wanted to kind of prove that you could beat his Dalsim with Blanca.
Yeah, you know, I just felt it was like a little arrogant, you know, because like honestly, like nobody really acted like that seriously, you know.
Right.
Really?
But you know, we played and he beat me pretty good. You know, He won the tournament. I got second. I think Mike got third or something like that. But
Watson.
Mike Watson.
Now, was that frustrating to everybody to have the stranger come in and win this tournament?
I think, you know, during the time that I wasn't there, Jeff had been coming.
Okay.
I was in Japan for a while.
Right. Okay.
So, and honestly...
How long were you there?
I was there, I think, that time, maybe like, it was 10 days, but before that, I didn't go to Pico so much. You know?
Gotcha.
Yeah,
because
I was like, I was just like training in the valley and whatnot.
Right.
And I think I maybe went like a month before.
Okay.
And as far as I know, Jeff was fighting in, he's a Marine. He was in Desert Storm. We had, like, you know, the Persian Gulf conflict around that point. So, you know, he was busy with that, and that explains from what I know why we didn't see him, you know, so much in, like, you know, Street Fighter 2 days.
So how was he leveling up? Was he playing...
He was playing somewhere. I mean, I think he was playing at Camelot when he didn't have his, like, you know, military duty or whatnot.
Wow.
Yeah. But, you know, again, it's like, I mean, like... right after the tournament, you know, it's like, you know, Jeff's talking all this crap and, no Dalsum or no Blanca is going to beat my Dalsum. And he beat me down and I'm like, I was just like mad. I was like, man, damn it. You know, and then he comes up to me and he's like, hey man, good games. I'm Jeff. You know, he introduces himself and it's like, oh, I see, you know.
That's cool.
You sort of get, it's like, you know, this guy is like, you know, he's just really intense, you know.
Right.
And
right.
if you're like a strong player, I mean, whether you're the best or not, you have to believe that you're the best, you know.
Right.
Or else there's no reason to even play.
Yeah.
Yep.
And it's like, and that's why if you watch like, you know, like the pro boxers or whatnot, even if they lost to so-and-so, I mean, in their mind, maybe they're making excuses like, okay, but maybe he had this advantage or he was cheating or blah, blah, blah. Because like, as soon as you admit that like, okay, well, that guy's better, then you already lost mentally.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
You know what I mean? And that's the whole thing about it. And Jeff, I realized that, right? You know, after he came up to me and he was just like a super nice, really humble, respectful guy,
right.
You know? It's like, oh, I see the deal now. You know?
Right, that's cool.
And then we became really good friends after that.
And so. I mean, someone even mentioned it on there that they said LA Akira versus LA Akuma.
Yeah.
And I mean, you guys kind of created the nicknames at the same time.
Yeah, right? I think he might have had his before me. I'm not sure because I just, you know, on my own, I started playing Virtua Fighter in 94. And, you know, back then they had, they had like Ikebukuro Sarah or Shinjuku Jackie or, Kashiwa Jeffrey and stuff like that. I'm like, hell, I'm going to be LA Akira, man. So, and, you know, I was using that handle. I started working at Game Fan and, you know, like some of the reviews and whatnot. I mean, I had like my little character icon, and that was like the nickname.
Did anybody have nicknames before then?
No, nobody.
You
really
just used
had
your name. Yeah.
I mean, it was Tomohiro, Roger,
Mike Watson, John Choi.
Yeah.
I only started doing it because of Virtua Fighter, because you know, Street Fighter, even in Japan, nobody had like, you know, their special. As far as I know, nobody had like their special like handle or ring name. But, like, you know, they started doing some funny stuff for Virtua Fighter. It's like, I mean, there's one guy called, like, Izakaya Jackie or something like that. You know, Izakaya is like a Japanese bar or something. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Or it just started coming out with, like, these hilarious names.
That's cool.
Gotcha.
But it was like, wow, it's like, you know, they made, like, a character for themselves. You know what I mean?
Right.
So then, like, I'm going to do that too, you know, sort of thing.
So you're like, I'm LA Akira.
Essentially, that's
cool.
How it started, man.
That's awesome,
cool.
I didn't know.
Yeah. Well, do you want to take a quick
break? Yeah, let's take another break. Yeah, we'll... I mean, next segment should probably be the last one, I guess.
Okay, no problem. But...
I kind of want to know what happened to guys like Tomo and how things ended up with Jeff Schaefer and all that stuff.
Yeah. Okay, cool. So we'll be right back.
Hey, welcome back to Tuesday's show. We've just been reminiscing over early Street Fighter 2 times. And
history.
Yeah, lots of good stories. You were just saying during the break that you have lots of other stories that we can tell,
stories,
but
man.
We don't have enough
time
for all
those. I have like hours and hours worth more. You know,
Sick.
It's like we haven't even, we're still in Champion Edition.
Right.
We're
all
the way up to like Super Turbo and then Alpha and Alpha 2. And...
I also do want to mention one thing, though. I mean, obviously, this is largely a SoCal kind
of
thing
because
there's a lot of East Coast going on. NorCal, of course, had the Wolf Brothers and Nelson and all
of
those guys.
Yeah, I'm sure there was stuff all over the country.
Yeah.
But, you know, did you guys ever travel? You know, I know you traveled to Japan, but did you or anybody else travel more in the U.S.?
I think it was mainly, like, Tomo went back east at one point, and Mike went back east at one point, and they played in tournaments there. And, you know, like, I remember Mike told me that, you know, it's like they had some good players there, but, I mean... They were like, you know, like mid, like board range, you know, for Pico.
Right.
You know, I heard Mike told me that Jesse Howard was a very good player.
Jesse Howard.
But he was like maybe George Nago level, you know.
Right.
That's actually what he told me. So, you know,
George
is good, you know.
Yo,
George
is
definitely
amazing.
A good player. Yeah.
I always like to say George is my person because he went to UCLA.
Yeah.
He was the guy who never talked to me until I started beating him.
Oh,
and then he became my friend.
That's how he is. And you know what? Jeff has a very similar mentality. You know, and it's like, you know, if people don't understand that, you know, I got rubbed the wrong way when I first met Jeff, you know, because I'm like, who the hell is this? This guy's a jerk, man. So, but, you know, if you earn his respect, he's not just going to give you his respect. You know what I mean?
Right.
He's just that type of person. If you earn his respect, he will, you know, talk to you. And George is the same way.
George
is
totally
the same. George
is totally
the same.
Oh,
yeah. Right.
He will not talk to you unless you start winning.
Yeah, so. And when you do, it's like, hey, that guy's pretty good.
Yeah.
You know?
Hey, you're pretty good.
Yeah. But
so what ended up happening with Tomo and...
You know, Tomo kept winning all the champion edition stuff, and then, you know, every so often you get, like, this challenger coming in here, and, you know, this guy maybe was, like, pretty strong, maybe beat, like, some of us, but, you know, they get to Tomo, and then Tomo just, you know, wiped the floor with him for that. I mean, I've seen him, he's had some, like, hard fights, you know, he had some hard fights, but he just pulled it out in the end. And then, you know, Jeff, we started, like, training together and, like, hanging out and stuff like that. And, you know, just even with Tomo, I mean, I actually had, like, a Champion Edition machine in my house at one point. And, you know, Tomo and, you know, Watson and Jeff came over and stuff like that. And we'd all play and stuff. And it was great. You know, even Mike Pozzo came over at one point.
Yeah, Roger Sahavo had a Champion Edition machine at his house, too. And then once they converted...
Like during championship times?
Yeah. And then right when Hyper Fighting came out, he got the upgrade.
Wow.
And that's when I started visiting over there. So that was, like, my first period where I started really grinding in that game was at Roger's place.
Wow.
And it was always funny too, because back then it would always be till like 11 o'clock at night. We're Chinese, you know, we had the Chinese family, so we're like, me and my brother, like, we gotta go home now, it's late. And they would just be like, okay. And they would literally play till like 2 p.m., go to sleep, and then we would call Roger at like 5 and be like, can we come back? Yeah. No, 2 p.m. Like, they would play till like 2 p.m. Like, they would just play all
night. Like, the whole night?
Yeah, the whole night and play Hyper Fighting all night.
That's awesome.
And we didn't know. And then we would call them at, like, 5 o'clock after, like, 3 hours of sleep. We're like, hey, can we come back? And so, like, literally Roger was just playing Champion Edition, sleep for, like, 4 hours, and then just play Champion Edition.
Wow.
It was crazy.
That is crazy.
Yeah. Like I said, I mean, we had a really strong mix. And, you know, like, all those guys, anybody that got on the Pico board was really, really strong. There was also, I mean, Tomo, you know, a couple, even younger than Tomo, there was Mike Hernandez. I don't know if you remember him. He was like 11 or 12 years old, and he was just killing people. You know, he was like, at one point in Hyper Fighting, he was top 10. I think he might have been like, you know,
crazy. Maybe
he was like this like 12 or 13 year old kid. And people were scared as shit to lose to him because, like,
eventually showed up to Southern Hills Golfland during CVS2 days.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He played a little bit during CVS2, I remember. He just showed up all of a sudden. It was like, wait, this is... And I recognize his name from that Tomo board, from that interview, you know. So
He was so good. And people, like, we're like, you know, 17, 18 years old.
Mm-hmm.
We do not want to lose to, like, 11 or 12-year-old kid.
Yeah.
So we were, you know, we get in there. We're playing harder than we do against Tomo because we just don't want to be that guy. You know what I mean?
That's awesome.
It's like, oh, you're the guy, dude.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, it was pretty funny. But, you know, it kind of simmered down after, like, you know, Champion Edition got, like, sort of old. I actually went to Japan. I was in Kanazawa for about 3 months. I was going to start to study Japanese, but, you know, I did, like, a little, like, you know, half-ass job. Mm-hmm. I think most of the time I was just playing, like, Hyper Fighting, because Hyper Fighting just, like, came out at that point.
Right.
But, I mean, I wasn't around, like, strong players, you know. Mm-hmm. It was, like, it's a city. It's a big city, but, I mean, it's not, like, a Tokyo or Osaka.
Right.
And, you know, the arcade I was at, I was just, you know, pretty much, like, killing, you know, most of the guys there. So, I mean, you know, like, when that first started, you know, I was away, and then I came back, and then... That's when, you know, like, Hyper Fighting was really, really taking off.
Right.
And that's when Frank Klang started coming around. And, you know, playing against Frank and George and Mike Watson all the time. And, you know, obviously, like, one of the big matchups in that game was Ryu versus Yu.
Yeah.
Right? So, I mean, I would literally go to, like, UCLA at least, like, 5 days a week and then just play, you know, with George and Frank, you know.
Yeah.
And then, you know, playing with those guys, you start to get, like, a lot better. My foots got so good, you know. And that was just like the matchup to play. It was awesome.
Yeah.
Frank was so strong in that
Ryu versus Ryu was like, it's still one of the most fun
still
fights.
Good.
Yeah, it's always been the only mirror match that's been like amazing.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
When new versions of these games came out, like when Hyper Fighting came out, did Championship just die? Or did the Champion just die?
Literally, yeah. I mean, literally it's gone. Like as soon as the new one comes in, it's like, you know, old hat. Nobody even wants to touch it.
Because the one thing that, you know, we're leaving out is the Korean chip. Rainbow Edition, which blew up Champion Edition.
I mean, were you guys playing that, or was it just something screwed
around?
We
played it as like a novelty, but we realized like, all right, this isn't a real game.
Right.
But the problem was it was killing sales, and that's
it was.
And Japan was already developing Super at the time, and so it was James Goddard here in the U.S. and Capcom USA said, we need to combat this. So they said, all right, Capcom USA, you make this version of this game while we keep working on our CPS2 board version of this game.
Yeah.
And so it was James Goddard's idea to speed it up because all the Rainbow Editions were faster.
Right.
And that's why when Super came out, the speed dropped back down.
Right.
Because it wasn't a drop back down. They had already been developing it, and it had already been slow the whole time.
Right.
And so they actually incorporated some of the things that James Goddard put in the game, like up ball and stuff like that.
Right? And actually, DJ was his character design.
Yes. Right. They rewarded. There was supposed to be a Fei Long and a Fei Long clone, like Ken and Ryu.
Yeah.
But instead, they took away the Fei Long clone, let James Goddard create a character, and he wanted to make Billy Blanks.
Yeah, that's pretty much what
he told me.
Yeah, and
that's what he told me.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And there's DJ right there, so.
So, yeah, I mean, Hyper Fighting, there is actually, I think, like a period of maybe like 7 months or 8 months that Tomo didn't play Hyper Fighting or didn't go to the Pico tournaments.
Uh-huh.
Not sure what he was doing exactly, but, you know, we didn't see him come around.
Right.
And, you know, Jeff was pretty much at the top of the board with Mike.
Okay.
You know, it was pretty much like Jeff and Mike at the top of the heap. And then there were some, at one point, I remember Frank Quang also got number one.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
He got there?
Yeah, he got to the
okay.
number one spot at
okay.
one point. Frank was really, really strong.
Yeah.
You know, I think Jeff sort of like, you know, has him mentally as a rival. And I mean, I've seen Jeff, you know, they've gone back and forth. I think Jeff maybe got the better of him in the end. It was, Frank was a really strong player,
right,
man.
Right.
Frank was a really, really strong player.
Yeah. I remember because he went to UCLA, so I would play him there all the time. Yeah.
He's a super nice guy, too.
UCLA.
Yeah. He was super quiet.
Yeah.
Like, super quiet, shy kind of guy.
Yeah.
And then he would just destroy you. I always remember in Super Turbo, he was king of sweeping Guile's low forward.
Yeah, he was. He was
house.
Really, really good at
yeah.
that. Yeah.
It was like every time.
Every single time.
That.
He had
yeah.
the best percentage I've ever
yeah,
seen.
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. But the Hyper Fighting tournament, I don't know if you remember that. There was the biathlon, you know, tournament.
With the pinball machine. That was the
right.
pinball machine one.
That
right?
was
yeah.
that was the pinball machine
Wait,
one. And that's where, you know, at one point...
Wait, what is that one?
The official Capcom tournament where they were trying to promote the pinball machine
oh, okay.
at the same
right.
time. So they threw a tournament for both that and the pinball
Did
machine.
Did you have to play both? Is that what you mean? Or?
I think...
Yeah.
Yeah, I think
it was,
so.
It was basically you had to, you couldn't just enter one, you had to play both.
Yeah.
And, you know, we'd heard about this, it's like, yeah, Capcom National Tournament and blah, blah, blah,
mm-hmm.
and we're all really excited, and it's going to be at San Diego and Yellow Brick Road, and so, you know, this is like incentive to like start playing like hard,
mm-hmm.
you know, hardcore. We're still playing like pretty hard, but now it's like
mm-hmm.
even more incentive.
Right,
so,
right, right.
you know, all the usual pack, you know, like all the Pico players can just like, you know, really just like getting serious. And
mm-hmm.
I think everybody was down there. I was down there. George was down there.
Right,
Eric,
right.
Roger, everybody, you know.
Yeah. And Jeff Schaefer has a bunch of videos on YouTube, you know, where he just talks into a camera, talking
yeah.
about the old days. And I remember one of the episodes he talks about this tournament. And he talks about the weird fact that no one had ever seen this pinball
yeah.
game machine
that,
before.
That's exactly right. The pinball machine was not released.
Mm-hmm.
It was there. You couldn't play it in any type of arcade, right,
mm-hmm.
or anywhere. And they only had it. You know, the only time we ever got to play the pinball game was the night before the tournament at Yellow Brick Road, right?
Right.
So literally, I mean, what happened like the next day with the tournament was one of the most amazing thing. One of the most amazing things I've ever seen, like in video games, right? At least for me.
Uh-huh.
And that was, like, during this time, I think, you know, Mike was having some, like, you know, pretty close matches with Tomo,
uh-huh.
You know, in, like, the Pico tournaments and
right,
whatnot.
Right.
And you know, in the when it came to, like, that, you know, the biathlon tournament, we had to, like, both, we not only play, you know, not only play, like, a Hyper Fighting, but we had
uh-huh.
to play, like, the pinball, right?
Right?
So most of us, we don't play pinball.
Right.
Right.
We don't, all we play is, like, you know, like, Street Fighter. So,
awesome.
And then there are also these, like, pinball pros that would, like, you know, came
oh,
down.
Right.
They're these guys who are just, like, these pinball masters.
That's
yeah.
awesome.
Yeah, that don't even know how to throw a fireball or
uh-huh.
anything,
uh-huh.
you know. They just had no clue about
That's
the game.
Awesome.
Uh-huh.
But they thought they're going to show up, and they're going to at least get some sort of prizes just because they
pinball,
did
right.
from the pinball. And there are, like, a lot of these guys. There are quite a few. You know, there are at least, like, seven or eight guys that were just really, really awesome at pinball.
Right, right.
And that's
right.
all they did, right? So, anyways, the video tournament starts, and, you know, we all, you know, it basically, like, whittles down to, like, I think, Waysit. I don't know if you remember him.
Mm-hmm.
He did, he was a San Diego player. He did
okay.
pretty good, but I think in the finals, it was Mike versus Tomo.
Right.
And I think, as far as I remember, Mike, I'm sorry if this is incorrect, but I think Tomo won three games straight.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. So if I'm wrong, I'm sorry, and I'm not trying to dog anybody. But then after that, and you know, keep in mind, we've been hanging out with Tomo for like the most part for like the last couple
mm-hmm.
years. Tomo walked over to the pinball machine and he scored a billion or something like that on his first ball.
So Jeff Schaefer said literally like he flipped the game stuff like that.
What? Yeah.
And Tomo couldn't have been secretly playing this game because we were hanging out with him all the time, you know.
Right.
And the only time we got to actually play this pinball game was the night before.
That's
and he
crazy.
Played it as much as we did.
Right.
You know, so like all of a sudden, you know, these pinball pros that, you know, like came here, they thought they were going to get up.
Right.
Tomo crushed all those guys too. You know? It was insane.
Awesome.
It was just,
so
it was
weird.
Just really crazy. So like, you know, after that, it's like, you know, anybody that was kind of like on the fence for like respect for Tomo, that was just totally went out the window.
Yeah, that's crazy.
That was it.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, all right, yeah, he's awesome. He's the guy.
Yeah.
So.
Pretty much.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it was a pretty fun time, and you know, it was just pretty amazing. You know.
That's awesome. But I mean, at this point, like when Super came out, it was slow. It kind of killed the scene a little bit, right?
I think so. I mean, I think people were excited about the new characters, you know.
Right.
But
right.
at the same time, it's like, I mean, they got used to like the speed of Hyper Fighting,
right?
You sure. know, so like it's like, whoa, this is a lot slower. This is weird, you know. And like, people played it. People definitely played it. And, you know, I was excited because even the old character has got, like, new animations and new moves. And, like, I mean, I was playing Claw a lot at that point.
Oh, yeah.
You know, Claw had some really nice new animations.
The very first time I saw Claw in Super, it was seriously, like,
totally
the most
different
beautiful
looking.
Yeah,
yeah,
it looked
he
amazing.
He was animated so
I thought the same thing. That's that's why I played him, you know. And, like, you know, strong and, you know, he's standing strong, standing forward.
He had 7 animations.
In the original...
7 normal move animations.
Yeah, total.
Yeah.
Like jab, strong, fierce, jab, strong, fierce. Like, it was all the same.
Well, fierce and roundhouse were this little
Yeah. But even
thing,
his kicks,
but...
like, hitting kick, he would stab.
Only, it was only sweep.
Yeah, it was really bad.
Yeah,
so.
That was a kick.
Yeah,
but that was awesome. You know, we played it, but, I mean, again, I mean, I think Hyper Fighting, people were happy with Hyper Fighting because it was just, like, a faster, it felt like, I mean, once you get used to that speed, it's really hard to go back to something slower.
And it's super balanced, too,
yeah.
right? Oh, my God, did they put that picture up?
Well, this is from 97, so this is later.
Yeah, that's the...
It's Marcus Arrow on the bottom.
That's the infamous Chicago tournament, I think it is, or
is it?
Maybe, I don't, yeah, because Derek Daniels is in that picture.
Wow,
that might have been that's
crazy.
Did they link it in the chat?
Yeah, that's where I got the picture from. We're talking about this picture that somebody just linked.
Okay, well,
that Proxford just linked.
Oh, okay, gotcha. But yeah, I mean, after that, then, you know, the legend has it that by the time Super Turbo came out, that's when Tomo started dating, right? And that's kind of where he disappeared.
Yeah,
right?
We didn't see him, even in, like, middle of Super. I remember he played at a High Tech 21 tournament, and then after a while, it was just basically like Mike. You know, Mike was,
right.
Tomo, Jeff was playing still, but Mike was really, really good at Super. I remember that. The thing is, though, there was, I think, one point where, I think Jeff told me this, I wasn't there for that, but when Super first came out, they went to Jeff and Mike and Tomo went to, I think it was like Pac-Man Arcade, and then just from what I hear, like Tomo just had his way with like both, you know, Mike and Jeff.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And
okay.
That Jeff
so
actually
was,
told me about
still
that.
Good
so,
this,
yeah,
right,
I mean, actually,
right.
I think Jeff was telling me that, like, Super made him better because it was like, you know, he could see everything so much easier. You know what I mean?
Right.
So, like, I mean, being used to, like, a faster game and then going back to, you know, like, a slower game, it's just really tough.
Yeah, so this is the picture I just put up. That
oh,
was
you just
linked.
Put it up?
I just put it up, yeah.
Oh,
so,
right.
So, actually, let me turn on the mouse pointer so I can tell everybody who everybody
okay.
is.
Okay.
Actually.
I mean, this is obviously a little bit later than what we were just talking about.
Oh, yeah, much, much later. But
it's still
funny, though. The,
yeah,
so.
Yeah.
All right, so you can see the mouse pointer here. Right here on the very left, this is Tom Cannon right here. Young Tom Cannon. Standing next to him is Derek Daniels, a.k.a. Omni.
Yeah.
Worked on God of War 1 and 2, right? So he knows
still around. He doesn't play very much, but he shows up to tournaments now.
Next to him, the tall guy is Rob Ingram, Cali Sean.
Yeah.
He shows up to Wednesday Night Fights
every
once
in
a while.
Yes, he does.
And then next to him, in the very back, is Mr. Dave Serlin.
So, somebody asked, is that Ultra David in the glasses? No.
No.
No, it's not.
And then, so that's Serlin in the back, in the middle there. Next to him is John Choi, of course. Above him is Tony Cannon. And then there's Alex Valle. I mean, look at him, dude. He's But then crouching down there is Mark Acero, another really old school player.
Yeah,
as well.
Mark's been around
yeah.
for a long time.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure this was the Chicago tournament that happened, where this was the Midwest tournament for Street Fighter III.
Yeah.
The original Street Fighter 3, Midwest said they were going to beat us down. We set, there was 16 people in the tournament. No, there was more than 16 people, but we ended up flying out 8 SoCal people, and we got 7 out of the top 8 spots.
What? How did they pay to go out? They just pay?
They just
went?
Except for Troy and Vi. They paid them, and that was the infamous trip that they became friends.
Oh, yeah, I've heard about
finally.
That.
So basically, Troy and Vi had been rivals forever since B3 and such, right?
Yeah.
And then on the way back, or on the way there, I think it was, their luggage got flown somewhere else. They got stuck in Phoenix. And so they just ended up talking, and they became really good friends. And Mike Watson still says to this day that was the biggest mistake Vi ever made, was becoming friends with his number one rivals. So,
that's awesome.
Yeah, but I think third place went to a young player from the Midwest.
Okay.
But outside of that, the top 8 spots were all SoCal. Yeah.
You know, the first ever Street Fighter 3 tournament that we had here was at Southern Hills Golfland, and I played in that. I lost to John, and then I lost to, I think it was maybe John put me in the losers bracket, and then Alex and I had a really close match. I remember I was actually really good at the first version of Street Fighter 3.
Yeah.
So I mean, George and I, we had the game at Game Fan, and we just like figured everything
that's
out,
right,
man.
That's right. Like, no, I played in that tournament. Yeah. I was in that tournament too. I remember playing that tournament.
John knocked me into. I was playing Dudley versus Yin, and then he had this strategy we'd never seen before: just trip him. You know, just trip Dudley. You know, because it was a weird timing. Uh-huh. So like, you'd throw off your parry timing if you tried to like parry down. Because
right.
we had this, we started this in like just George and I. We just when we like attacked with like, let's say like Ryu or Dudley, we just walk down forward, down forward, down forward, down forward,
right?
And if we don't get a reaction, we throw,
right?
And then as soon as you see that parry, you know, come
right. Because people don't know that you could actually down parry anything that you could low block, you could down parry, so there wasn't like only straight parry moves like a Ken close stand strong.
Yeah.
You could parry that down. And parries were too good.
Right.
So,
yeah.
And then basically John, I mean, he was using a low sweep. You know, like a low sweep. Yun had that. Yun and Yang, same character.
Right.
At that
right.
Point. Uh-huh. They had that low sweep that it would just trip you, but it was a weird timing because the animation would start, but the parry timing was a split second later.
Right.
So I kept getting tripped and then kept getting combos. And John was the strongest at that point. He beat Alex pretty bad in that
first
tournament.
Place.
Yeah.
I don't know how you guys remember all these tournaments, man. Like,
I still remember.
Like, I can't remember tournaments from 2 months ago.
The second
like
Street Fighter 3 tournament is probably one of the ones that I got. This was example of early corruption because I got to winners finals with Vi.
Okay.
I was in winners finals. I used Alex at the time, and he destroyed me with Stan Roundhouse. Right.
Who was he?
Ryu.
Okay.
It was just that Roundhouse kick.
Right.
But I was in winners finals. Right.
Right.
Somehow I ended up playing like 4 more people and ended up in 4th place. I lost.
That sucks, man.
Who got ahead of you?
Like, I think Schaefer was one of them. It was basically the Southern Hills Golfland gang. Tao, you remember?
Awesome.
Tao was
yeah.
really good back then.
Tao was good, yeah.
Yeah, and literally, after the tournament I was done, I had thought about it. I was like, wait a minute, I got to winner's finals against Alex Vai in this game. How did I not get top 3 in this tournament, you know?
Yeah, you're still
let
mad
it go.
About this.
Yeah, and
let
it was
go,
corrupt. Yeah, I know, really, seriously.
That's amazing.
Okay, okay.
Amazing.
Anyways.
So I think we skipped like, you know, some time.
Yeah,
we definitely did.
Super turbo
but,
stuff. And,
you know, we'll probably have to wrap it up again.
That's fine.
Yeah,
you know,
that's fine.
Well, we
point,
could maybe if, I don't know, if you guys want
to
do this some other time. We
I'd
could,
love to, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We
pick it up with Super
do that.
Turbo and then get into like the alpha. We still left out all the like the alpha 1 and 2 days.
Yeah,
and,
dude.
Oh, yeah,
yeah,
for sure.
I actually want to hear about Darkstalkers too in that period of time. Cause
you know, no one really played it competitively.
Yeah,
no one ever picked it up competitively.
It was a really cool game. It's too bad.
Yeah, the first Darkstalkers, and the interesting thing that a lot of people don't know is the first Darkstalkers was really, really controlled. It was not a crazy rushdown game or anything like that. Like, it was actually...
It came out before Alphas, right?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It was the experiment. It was the second series that they did.
Yeah, it was the
fighting game series.
It was the experiment for the new animation style. They were trying to make a whole brand new game with that animation style, and they basically did that whole thing, and then... I don't know what happened because Alpha came out and Alpha looked like crap compared to Darkstalkers.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know why. I mean, like, you know, the number of frames of animation, you know, from Street Fighter 2 was just so much more than Alpha.
Yeah,
you know, it's like, well, why did it get ugly?
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
I mean, I'm not saying it's ugly. I liked the art style.
Yeah,
but,
yeah, yeah.
I mean, the animation, I think the animation was, like, more fluid in Street Fighter 2, honestly.
Yeah. Anyway, I guess we're going to wrap it up.
Yeah.
So thanks a lot for coming on and talking. This has been really interesting, and I hope you guys have all enjoyed this. So.
Yeah, I know. And you know, it's a shame because there's so much history, and we don't get to talk about it that often. So
I'm glad that we had a chance.
Yeah, especially because you were right in the mix. You were in there. You were playing with Tomo and Mike and all those guys, so it's really cool to get your perspective on all of this. So.
Well, thanks for having me.
No, seriously, for sure. Thanks for coming by and spending like 6 hours of your life in the last 2 days.
Awesome, man. You know, I'm just just happy that, you know, like people are actually interested and want to hear these stories, you know, because I thought they're just, I was going to take them to the grave and nobody.
Oh, you know? if you want to see it, you know, just let us know.
Dude, some people are saying come back next week, do this again, please, you know, so it sounds like,
a lot. Okay, cool. Awesome.
And they want us to bring Tomo and Jeff Schaefer.
Oh, that'd be awesome, dude.
Dude, we can find them.
I just actually just talked to Jeff, like, maybe before I came over here, you know.
Oh, really?
Because we're still friends. We talk all the time. I'm like, hey, man, I'm going over to James's, you know. So he's like, hey, Tom, I said hi. So we could, Jeff talks to Tomo a lot.
Right.
Actually, he actually told me that he's, like, teaching him golf, right? So they're both,
Now they're competing in golf?
No, Jeff has been playing golf for a very long time. Right. He's really good.
But I just picture Tomo now just being like, I'm going to beat this guy with only one arm golf, you know,
and stuff. Yeah, beat him with low forward.
Yeah, seriously. Oh, that's awesome. Okay. Well,
we'll look into that.
We're not that old. We don't want to end with that, so.
We'll be playing Street Fighter till we go to the grave.
Hope so. Yeah. All right. Thanks for tuning in, watching. We'll be back next week, next Monday, of course, 8 p.m. We're going to have First Attack and Level 3 Focus as per usual, and we'll be back on next Tuesday at 8 p.m. for whatever we're calling the Tuesday show that week.
Mm-hmm. And of course, you can follow Gerald at LA Akira. Again, Virtua Fighter 5 is out for
Final
PS3. Final Showdown, right, is out for PS3 now and tomorrow for Xbox 360.
That's right.
Correct.
I wanted to mention two things I forgot from yesterday. Remember, I was like, I can't remember that.
But I don't remember what those
were. One of them was that, you know, I wanted to mention that Sega is putting in a $15,000 pot at Evo for a special tournament over there.
That's right.
And then the other thing.
The netcode.
The netcode. Yeah, right. See, he remembered. Yeah, we wanted to mention that because you've been playing with Haunts up north.
Yeah, I've been actually, I probably played about 70 games before I came over here today.
Right.
Stopped at E3. I just wanted to test it out. But, you know, the netcode, if anybody's played Virtua Fighter 5, the netcode is way better than Virtua Fighter 5. And, you know, cross-country, you could get pretty damn solid connections.
Awesome.
If you're playing from here to Europe, that's another thing. I honestly think it's a little bit too far. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, if you're just still learning the game, you might be able to have fun with it. Right. But, I mean, I played some date that's about 100 miles away. And then we had a totally legit connection.
Oh, that's so awesome. Cool.
Yeah. Well, hopefully that sticks around post-launch.
Yep. So once again, follow Gerald Abraham, a.k.a. L.A. Akira, a.k.a. White Gerald, for those who really know the whole history. Yeah.
Okay.
Ben Curtin came up with that.
Because there was a Gerald up north who was African-American, so we called him Black Gerald.
Yeah.
And
we're became White both Gerald. Of us in the same place. I mean, how are you going to tell the difference?
Yeah, exactly.
Of course.
They say Gerald, and we both look.
L.A. Akira on Twitter. And pick up Virtua Fighter 5, and, you know, hopefully we'll have you back sometime very soon so we can do some more of this.
Cool, man.
All right.
Awesome. All right.
Well, thanks, everybody.
See ya.